And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, and most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and with me I have a newcomer into the temple, coming to us straight from Zenesis Studios, and the creator of the Zenesis TTRPG. The one and only, the man better known as Nezero. How's it going? How you doing, everyone?
I'm doing pretty all right. Yep. I've just been, going at it just normally. Mm-mm. But yep. Work is as usual. Mm-hmm.
And so, the best place for me to start would be the humble beginnings, as I usually do. With that in mind, walk me through your first introduction to role-playing games and what made it stick.
So when I was in my early years of college, right shortly after getting out of high school, some of my friends that I hang out with in real life, we tend to hop around from game place to game place. They carry all sorts of different things. One of my friends noticed the starter kit for D&D, the big green box with the dragon on the front. Yeah. Of course, D&D is so infamous at this point, even before COVID and everything else had happened, that everybody kind of knows what it is to an extent, and a bunch of my friends are interested. So we decide to all go partially in on buying this tabletop thing, and they go, essentially, well, you're basically the big nerd amongst all of us. You're going to college for game design. Why don't we just slap this down with you, and you can figure out how it works and take us through it later.
No pressure.
Yeah, no pressure, none. To which I sat down, and I was like, wow, this is going right over my head. I don't know why it isn't clicking. So I got another friend of mine from high school that was also attending the same college to basically sit down one day with me and take me through the basics of setting it up. And for a while before I got my friends involved, I played somebody who was more familiar session to kind of get the idea of how it broke down for a while. And as I played then, got a little bit more of an idea, got into the groove of doing it, I eventually felt courageous enough when that campaign came to a rather abrupt halt due to whatever reasons on the DM's end, to try start hosting my own. Well, my first hosted session was actually a homebrew session. It didn't use the, I think my box came with like Ghosts of Saltmarsh or something like that inside of the box, but I'm the kind of person who gets most involved with my own games, my own ideas, or series that I intrinsically care about. So I decided to homebrew out an entire session based around Zelda. At the time, it had been Breath of the Wild, the most recent release, and I'm still running that session. It's been 4 years. I've gone through a bunch of players, a lot of people who have been there since the start, some people who have had to dip since the beginning, but and I went from being completely blind to a newbie GM to a fairly I would say avid and very active homebrewer and a pretty well experienced GM.
Because I do remember somebody asking me what it takes to be a seasoned GM, and I said I become a seasoned GM next week.
you're really not off. So when you pick up that mantle, you kind of like have to ask yourself, you're just like, when will I finally be at the level of, and everybody loves to look at people like Brendan Lee Mulligan and Matthew Mercer as like the standard of, oh, that's a pro GM. And the answer is you become a pro GM when your players actively look forward to your sessions. There's no greater sign that you've really made it than your players groaning in disappointment when you're done and constantly messaging you about your session when you're not playing.
Yeah. And it's funny you mentioned Matt Mercer, because at my LGS, because I do a whole lot of one shots there, especially around Free RPG Day. I ended up contributing to the creation of a Wayne's World style sign on the wall that says absolutely no Matt Mercer.
Yeah,
I was getting sick of people, because the guy who runs that store has been my best frenemy for decades, and I admit, as I was wrapping up, I was kind of ranting about how people kept bringing him up, and it was getting really annoying to hear somebody go, well, that's not how Mercer did, and I'd have to respond, I'm not Mercer. And I offhandedly say, I wish I had a sign, like the No Stairway sign from Wayne's World up on the wall. Then I come in a week later and I see exactly that.
God, that's so fantastic, actually. Matthew Mercer is great in a lot of ways. So is Brandley Mulligan. They're both really great personalities, and they're really responsible for, I would say, the major updraft we see in the interest in tabletop RPGs now. But as great as they are, you know, because they're professionals at the end of the day, like, they aren't professional GMs necessarily. Of course, at this point, they're recognized as such, but they're professional, like, voice actors or professional comedians, you know, like, you look at all the stuff that Brendan Lee Mulligan does outside of his games, and you realize, like, how much work he puts into being so very good at what he does. The same goes for Matthew Mercer. Matthew Mercer is now playing Ganondorf in Tears of the Kingdom. He played, I think it's now Cassidy in Overwatch. He was a professional voice actor, so everybody expects you to be, like, this one-man, like, you know, playwright of being able to sound like the Wicked Witch of the West and a little girl, while you're really a 6'2" grizzly bear of a man with a monotone and a baritone. And it's like, no, I don't have that much skill. Mercer's great because he gets everybody into it, but he's also a very terrifying and fairly hard to surmount wall, proverbially.
Mm-hmm. And with that in mind, was the creation of Xenesis a case of just house ruling your way through 5e until it became something else?
Yay and nay. When I started making Xenesis, I had actually just gotten off of a surgery that left me minorly incapacitated. Basically just made it hard to move. It was nothing serious. But I was in college for game dev at the time, and I was approaching the end of my college career, and one of the things they really beat over your head in that degree is that basically everything and everyone in that industry looks at what you can make. They look at your portfolio, first and foremost. Before years of experience, they want to see... It's nice on paper if you have the skills, but it doesn't matter if you actually don't actually have them. And when you're incapacitated like that, drawing is impossible. All you're doing is basically laying on your side all day. And so typing was much easier. At that point, I had gotten familiar enough with D&D homebrewing. And I kind of had this realization... that D&D is kind of limited in a lot of ways. Not like necessarily in a bad way, but generally when people are like, I like D&D for the simplicity, and you realize how much of D&D is left to house rulings on the GM's part.
Yeah, there's a whole section of, we left it blank so that the players could come up with it, like, say, item creation.
Yep. And, When I was looking at that, I was like, well, D&D is great because it allows you a lot of flexibility, but sometimes it really helps having those guidelines, whether or not you're new or whether or not you're or whether or not you just want to build something specific. You would be surprised. Tabletop RPGs, in a lot of ways, you could think of them like Legos. The intrinsic and most important part to homebrewing anything is making sure that there's a core rule that you can use to benefit yourself and actually making it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So you get into something like D&D where it's so freelance, and then you're like, okay, well, I'm tired of everything being so freelance. What other systems can I play? And the first thing that you will ever hear out of anybody else's mouth is Pathfinder.
Which is kind of like I guess taking a drink of milk out of the fridge, realizing that it's sour, putting it back in the fridge, and going, maybe tomorrow it'll be fresh. Like you're not really, if you jumping from D&D to Pathfinder in that sense is not really fixing anything. You're just trading one problem with a new problem.
Yeah, and one thing that, because I've looked at the Pathfinder, and Pathfinder is really intimidating when you look at it from the outside. Because, like, you go from, like, so there's obviously a lot of D20 RPGs. Like, I think of GURPS, I think of D&D, I think of Pathfinder. If you're going from D&D to Pathfinder, that's like going from a tricycle to a unicycle. Like, that's the best way I could put it. Pathfinder is very uber specific from what I've seen. It's got a lot of rulings, and it's very deep, but it's also very complex. And so, even if you're a GM with quite a few years of experience, it can be intimidating when you're looking at it from the outside to get into a system like that. What I wanted from a system was something that was more complex than D&D. Or rather, I guess the better way to say it is, I wanted something that ran with more depth than D&D, but didn't have all the kind of cluttered complexity that comes with Pathfinder, where Pathfinder is a lot of rulings lock in specific situations and circumstance.
Mm-hmm. And to that end, I know I made the joke about the item creation issue, for instance. But this is probably something that you came to the conclusion of. Having that freeform is nice, but you can go too far with it where it feels like you're being pushed off the edge of the pool right into the deep end.
Yeah. Like a lot of people that start homebrewing are almost always intimidated by the amount of choice that is at their fingertip. In that regard, a lot of people tend to go overboard on their initial homebrews, and then they kind of learn what does and doesn't work by running those items in their homebrews. I'm guilty of creating several overpowered items. I think that's kind of the trademark of I've started homebrewing, is the first item you make is always guaranteed to be either under or overpowered. It's very hard to hit a good stride because people will break your items. They will break your items. That's all there is to it.
Yeah, but and I'd say that over underpowered issue is a consequence of a lack of guidance.
Oh, definitively. Uh-huh. It's hard to figure out, like, you know, how long of a duration should I make something last if it's going to be a continuous effect? How powerful should I make it be if it's an immediate effect? How many times should it be usable if I should limit the number of times it can be used? Or in what way should I limit the ways in which it can be used? Must I use it as a ritual? Must I expend a charge from it? How do the charges reset? You know, things like that.
Mm-hmm. So with all of that in mind, one of the big things to note just from what I was able to glean is an expanded and it seems like kind of a second look at a lot of class design, because for one you have classes split up into three major categories: combatants, arcanists, and spellcasters. Would it be fair of me to say that arcanists are meant to be like gishes or half casters?
They are very much like a half caster. They're meant to be a strike balance between the fluid, I guess, options that you get with basically the versatility of a spellcaster, while maintaining a level of competency in either ranged or close combat. They're kind of meant to be the filler, you know what I mean? Like, lacking in magic, too much magic, or lacking in firepower, you know, things like that. It's smart to play an Arcanist, because they're not just, like, you know, some little one-off kind of, like, one-trick pony. They're all designed to do something versatile in relation to what the others can do.
Mm-hmm. And I would like to kind of when it comes to class design, is it operating under a lot of the same principles as 5e's approach of the proficiency bonus getting a set of proficiencies and the relationship with classes and subclasses, or are you doing something a bit different on that front?
So, yes. It does pertain a lot to the same way that D&D does do their class systems. It's you get assigned a class, that class assigns your hit die, that class gives you your saving throw proficiencies, it gives you an option of skill and tool proficiencies to pick from. It gives you your starting equipment. It gives you your, I believe I already said hit dice. Much like D&D, not all of the skills that you get come from exclusively your class. They come from your background, too. And your backgrounds actually give you a unique thing to each background that is not optional to take as a talent. So talents replace features. If I had to put it in D&D terms in my system. There's a lot of talents in my system that play into later combat, boosting your proficiencies, things like that, making you stronger, making you more durable. But backgrounds have certain talents that are exclusively locked to them. And where D&D leaves a lot of those background features or feats or whatever you want to call it very vague sometimes, where you're kind of like sitting there and you're not sure what they're going to do for you if they don't supply you with some immediately quantifiable benefit. I always, in the talent section for backgrounds, they always state outright what it is that they do for you. And their benefits are clearly stated. Sometimes it could be a skill proficiency, sometimes it could be tool proficiency, sometimes it could be extra money, sometimes it could be something that you'll bump into later on. Like there's an amnesiac one, whose talent is to basically swap skill proficiencies out later once you gain your memories and things like that.
Yeah. But with that in mind, I'm curious if you're doing the same ASI or feat every four levels that 5e is doing, or if you had something else in mind.
ASIs are present in my system, but they're not every four levels. They're based differently off of what class you're playing. Sometimes they show up more frequently, sometimes they show up less frequently, and the way in which they can be used is a little bit more flexible than what D&D allows. One thing that I actually wanted to bring up that is actually quite different in my system as compared to D&D is that spellcasters and arcanists, both of which are capable of using magic, do not have their spell levels. I call them spell points in my system. Their spell points are not tied to your class. They're tied to an entirely separate system, which I can delve in on if you would like, but first I'd like to answer that question of ASIs. So ASIs are simply referred to as prowess increases, and while prowess increases can be used to increase ability scores, they can also be used to obtain talents, they can be used to obtain mastery, and they can be used to they can be used to increase talents or gain masteries in skills, tools, or actually weapons as well.
Mm-hmm. I'm guessing masteries is your answer to proficiencies.
Expertise. Yes, and compared to the way that expertise doles itself out, it's not based off of your proficiency bonus. It's based off of your ability scores and the like. So basically, the stronger you are at something strength-based, let's say like athletics, if I had to give a example, if you were masterful in that and you had a +5 in your strength modifier, it would become a +10, not including proficiency bonus, if you were masterful in athletics.
Mm-hmm. So with that in mind, I'm a bit curious if since on the character sheet you sent me, there's a little spot just for class feature resources. Is it a case where a good amount of the classes you have are going to have their own resource pool exclusive to them?
Yes. So many of the combatant classes, especially, have a lot of basically numerical use features. Basically, you have a number of uses of this specific attack or a number of uses of this specific feature equal to, and then it could be something like a set amount, it could be something tied to an ability score, it could be a one and done kind of thing that class is for keeping track of. They're basically like they could be used for specific attacks. They could be used for denoting basically what class feature you're currently in use of. Like, because not every class feature is use specific, it could be a good way of monitoring what class feature you have active that might be passive, that might be like a passively active things. Like one of the classes in my system is called Ronin, and Ronin has a set of stances that they can take, and by using those stances they gain benefits to either their defense or their attack depending on what stances they take. That section could also be used for that.
Mm-hmm. Now with that in mind, since you mentioned Ronin, I am curious when it comes to the mercenary, because a jack of all trades type of character that in various editions of D&D that's been tried. I mean the bard is one of the big examples of this kind of thing, but it's hard to really do that with a game built around classes.
Right.
So I'm curious how you're going to handle that.
Mercenary is meant to fill out a sort of like gap. So mercenaries come in and they're kind of good at doing a little bit of everything. So they have options in their subclasses for becoming a half caster. If your party starts out and they don't know what they want to be, and you find yourself I'm sorry, I said half caster, I meant to say arcanist. Mm-hmm. To become an arcanist later, they tend to have a lot of skill availability to them. They tend to have a lot of tool proficiencies available to them. They tend to compound on those as time goes on, getting either better with the skills that they have or increasing their proficiencies with the tools. Since they're kind of good at everything, they can fill out a range area. They're not so squishy as to be necessarily in the back, but they are not so tanky that they would necessarily be the foremost frontliner, though they can be depending on what subclasses you take. Really, mercenary is my base class starts out with a lot of features that are generally good and useful in almost any situation, whether it's combat or out of combat. Outside of combat, but their other subclasses are meant to cover basically as your playstyle goes on and you figure out what your party wants to be and what it's doing. That's where mercenary kind of plays in. Mercenary is a class that you basically look at and you're just like, oh, okay, well, I'm going to look at what features I get for this subclass down the line. Since it's got a lot of versatility, I can maybe be a frontline tank, I could be a half caster, I could be more focused on range if it seems like my players are going to be going face tank, you know what I mean? Things like that. Mm-hmm.
So, with the and when it comes to art, when it comes to things like the arcanists, because a lot of times the approach that's done with half casters is they get some other stuff, but they don't get as many spell slots. Since you're doing something a little bit different and separating spell availability from class, it sounds like. What is the benefit and trade-off when it comes to the Arcanist classes in a whole?
So, Arcanists do stop their spell points at level 5, but if I had to put it this way, the number of spell slots they can get still grows with their level. So it's not like, okay, now I've reached level 5, I'm not going to get any more level 5 in my spell casting, I'm not going to get any more spell points. It's as your level keeps on increasing, you're still getting spell points for level 5 and down, assuming your table has increases for it. So in that way, you're getting more spell points than what would normally be permitted with a spell with a half caster in D&D, and since you're earning them at the same pace that a spellcaster would, it doesn't really feel like in the later game you're really lagging all that far behind. It's like, okay, I'm keeping up with with the full casters for now, and then the full casters pull ahead of you. If we're talking about the ways in which they do manage to separate themselves, so the five classes, which I'm sure that you've noted on the provided supplements, are Alchemist, Shaman, Golurgist, Spellstoner, and Gunman. Mm-hmm. They all kind of do something a little bit different from each other. Alchemists are utility, I would say. They are really good at subterfuge, doing things subtly from a distance, setting things up like traps and things like that. Causing little subtleties in the situation to change what is occurring around you. Like, oh, this object gets hot enough and now it's lit on fire. This object is now so cold that it can barely be handled. I've taken the time to basically sit down here and draw out an alchemic circle, and I've set a spell within it, and now whenever an enemy walks over it or something like that, whatever pretense that I want to set for this alchemic circle, somebody walks over it, it causes that to happen. A lot of their subclasses are based off of either creating medicines, like what we call phials, which is the replacement for potions, in my system, but also things like poisons. They can create things like homunculi, and to an extent they can bring back the dead, provided you have the materials and do things as according to the class features. The shaman is one that is actually a little bit more utility in an atypical way. In my system, there's this pre-existing system for called curses. And curses can apply detriments to all sorts of different things. In particular, you can apply them to objects, you can apply them to people, you can apply them to even plots of land or structures. Shamans are really good at ritual casting, and they get features that really compound this. They get features that make it faster and easier for them to ritual cast. They make it they're a little bit more about giving you perhaps benefits if you're setting yourself up to fight something or someone specific, or if you're going to be like luring somebody into traps. Unlike alchemists, they're a little bit more a little bit less CQC, and they're a little bit more about like getting features that use the environment to your advantage, like ignoring the detriments of terrain and things like that. Also getting specialized features that allow you to use aspects of the terrain to your advantage that mix with certain weapons that you can use, things like that. Golurgists are people who make golems, and golems are really useful in that they are basically just little extra face tanks. You get a number of uses that you could summon, and there's a limit to how many you can control at once. But if you're feeling like you're getting outnumbered, they're really good for being walls, because not only do they like act as extra bodies for a fight, but they also act as if you can like choose to kill them off, or even if they die of natural means, you can use them as things like cover. So even when they die, they still have a purpose. They don't really scale super high in terms of attack power. Their health does scale, which means that they do fall off a little bit later. But most of the Golurgus subclass features compound ways in which you can use them, and there's other features later that allow you to make optionally tougher golems at extra cost to yourself. That could either be supplying outside resources, taking extra time, limiting the number of golems you can make to create a stronger golem, things like that. Spellstoners are... when I was making them, I kind of had this funny thought of, I've created this resource called Spellstones, and there's definitely at least a few people in there who have definitely at one point or another tried grinding up spellstones and either snorting or injecting it, because there's always some idiot who is willing to do something like that in a way. And so I was like, well, a spellstoner is going to be a little bit more of the tankier option of Arcanus. They're actually much more heavily CQC based than any of the other classes I mentioned thus far. Mm-hmm. They kind of serve, in a way, they're similar to the combatant class of grapplers, where they get up and they're about punching people, and they're about injecting themselves with certain types of elemental spellstones, and by doing that you get things like damage resistances, you get bonuses or benefits to your attacks that are specific to the kinds of spellstones you take. The kinds of subclasses that it based off of allow you to either end those benefits prematurely, compound those benefits, really exemplify them, you know, like, oh, this isn't working out for me. There's very few ways in which you can end the benefits of a spellstone immediately. And so there's classes that are like, I'm going to end this benefit early by expending a use of this, and I'm going to get this benefit in addition to expending the use of this feature. They're meant to be... If I had to describe them, they're meant to be like, I am going to dope out of my brain. I am going to go in here. I am going to punch. And if punching isn't going to work, then I'm going to use magic that is good at a close range, or I'm going to use something that is going to basically compound on myself to try to punch harder. Or I'm going to try to do something that's going to build some distance or get us some flexible positioning in this circumstance. They can act as a face tank, but that is not their sole role. And gunmen are, like the name implies, they're gunmen. They're the only class that has proficiency in firearms, which means that they're really good at fighting from a range. If I'm talking about the class that's probably best at fighting from a range in my system, I would have to say it's really a toss-up between either a certain subclass of my archaeologist class, which is a full caster, gunman, or potentially my javelineer class, which is another class we could talk about if you are so interested. But gunmen are better at close range. They're not quite as good at... they're better at long range, and they're not quite as good at close range. They do get things that they can do at close range, but most of the things that they can do at close range are for trying to build up the distance to allow them to get back to long range again.
Yeah.
Or they're good at a mid-range, you know. Mid to long is kind of the area where they sit, and there's three types of guns as of this current moment. Pistols, shotguns, and rifles. All of them use revolver-style loading, but the number of bullets you can have is really limited based off of the kind of firearm you're choosing to use. And in my system, there's things that are noted to be quality. Quality determines basically how good of an item you're making. And gunmen are really good at that. If I had to describe it, gunmen are like, this firearm that I have now isn't working out for me, so I'll go get the parts and I'll build myself a new one. and when I'm not building something for myself, because you can be out of combat with your allies, while the other things like alchemists are really good at building, making vials which will heal you and give you immediate benefits. Shamans are really good at making medicines which can give you benefits, but they take a longer time to activate. Golurgists are meant to be cover up for loss of numbers, and spellstoners are meant to be to a degree the arcanist equivalent of a face tank. But gunmen are like, my weapon is chipped, my weapon is breaking, my weapon is in a really dire strait. You go to the gunman because the gunman is the best at repairing things. They're very useful outside of combat, because when we talk about the classes that are going to be able to make you better items, gunman is one of probably about two classes, I would say, that are really good at making things outside of combat, with the other being archaeologist. And mercenary potentially being a good third.
Mm-hmm. So, with that in mind, we've kind of danced around it a bit, but I think it's as good a time as any to go, to dive headfirst into it. You are separating, you're separating spellcasting ability from classes. Before we even get into how that's gonna work, what made you come to that conclusion?
I thought, in a way, it was almost tragic. I don't know how to say, but it was kind of, in a way, how to put this? I pick up wizard, I pick up cleric, I pick up bard, and I know exactly when I get my spell slots, which could be comforting, but it can make a monotonous experience, you know what I mean? In that way, I wanted something at the core that was going to make it more interesting or give you more flexibility, because when you've played any system long enough, right, you are feasibly going to make, I won't say every class combination, but you're most likely going to play the classes you either like the most, and to a degree that can be great, but you can only play the same subclasses so many times. It's like, now I know when I'm getting my my subclass, I know what subclass features I'm getting, I know what spell slots I have. What I wanted was, I'm going to play this arcanist, or I'm going to play this spellcaster, and I don't have to play it the exact same way. I don't necessarily have to have the same amount of spell slots, or rather spell points, that I had at this level that I had at the last level, which is why I divided it up into three, because I really wanted players to have the opportunity to look at a class that they really like and have this realization of, I don't have to play this the exact same every single time, even when I'm considering playing a different subclass. I get to have... Because if you think of it like this, you can play every spellcaster and every arcanist three different ways using just that. And then assuming that every other every class has at least four subclass features, you figure that's 3 to the 4th power ways of playing that class using your magic origins. Mm-hmm. Which means you have about 81 different ways to play the exact same class, just by adding in that one intrinsic system.
Oh.
More or less. It's or like 12, something like that. I'm not.
Now, are magic origins basically the game asking and answering what sort of magic you draw upon? Like the like magic traditions or the like?
In a way, yeah. Magic origins are divided into three categories. Internal, spiritual, and pact. Internal magic is basically the way that magic origins are explained, if you don't mind me going on about this just a little bit, is that your magic is drawn from an actual physical organ within your body. That organ is basically, as you gain more levels, growing stronger, which is why you get more magic. Even combatants have them. It's just combatants' magic manifests differently. Combatants' magic manifests as external toughness, if I had to describe it away. So they don't actually get any spell points. Basically, internal is I draw upon solely the magic of my magic origin. It's the logic of if somebody goes to the gym and they work out every single day, they're going to be much buffer than somebody who goes to the gym and works out every other day, or somebody who goes to the gym twice a week, or things like that. Basically, your magic origin becomes a muscle, and how strong that muscle is gives you more magic, but that's all that it gives you, is more magic. There's nothing else to it other than that. It's basically, if you want to be a powerhouse for magical spell slots, sure, that's it. But you may not get the same benefits that other people get with different magic origins as time goes on. Spiritual casters are attuning yourself to the nature of spirits. Spirits within my particular setting are basically the embodiments of elements. When you enter a region, there are spirits naturally present, but you may not always be able to see them. They exist in a separate realm that, just for contingency's sake, I'll just list as the spirit realm. The spirit realm is basically where spirits live, and when spirits are not in the spirit realm, they're traditionally invisible unless they so choose to be on the mortal plane, or the main plane, as I've called it. By attuning yourself to the nature of magic, you kind of come to have a more median level spell slots. Pact is the lowest amount, internal is the highest amount, so spirit is the good intermediate balance. And the benefits that it gives you by attuning to that magical nature is the ability to either see magic or see spirits, depending on what route you want to take. And so that gives you versatility outside of combat to use a feature that is not exclusive to any sort of class. It's like, logically, magic casters should be able to a degree, denote when magic is present. Spirit casters are just much better at it because they can actually see it. Mm-hmm. And pact casters are, I have forged a connection with a higher power. Basically, there are several gods in my settings. They're listed in the documentation, but there's the primordial gods, which are essentially super mega spirits that were born at the dawn of the planet and or the solar system, depending on which one we're talking about. And then their children are what's called demigods. By forging a connection with such an entity, you gain your magic, and that entity sends upon you a divine messenger. And that divine messenger converts the raw mana that they take from their god into magic, something that you can use. And you can commune with that god to a degree. Your prayers are more likely to be answered the stronger you yourself are, because the stronger you yourself are, the stronger your companion comes, the more likely they are to be able to present themselves in front of the person who is giving you your magic. And in that degree, they also offer the lowest amount of spell points, but you regain them the quickest. Like in D&D, you have to normally rest to get your spell points back. And both spirit and internal take the longest form of rest to get back, but pact casters only take one of the shorter rests to take. There's three types of rest: power nap, short rest, long rest. And it takes a short rest to get your spell slots back as a pact caster, but they are the only ones that get their spell casting back on short rest.
Now, one of the things that I did notice is a kind of spell points per level. So I'm guessing you're not using the Vancian model of spells per day, then having to do a rest to recharge them.
No, the number of spells that you know is equal to the amount of spell points you have at the given level on your caster table. So it's like, I'm level X. I have, let's say, three level one spell slots, two level two spell slots, one level three spell slot. Spell points, I'm sorry. We're mixing terms so often, I'm getting a little tripped. But essentially, it's like, okay, well, I have one spell point for level three. That means I know one spell that is level three. I have two spell points that are level two. That means I have two spells that are level two. And so on and so forth.
Yeah. I'm guessing that's to mit. That this setup is to mitigate the issue that can happen where somebody knows more spells than they could cast.
Yes, one of the most common things I find happening, not only in my session but in general, is that a lot of casters, in various systems get all of their spells, and half the time that means players don't know what half the spells they have are anyways. And even if they do know what spells they have, there's a 50-50 shot at whether or not they will actually have it prepared for when they do need to use it, which means ultimately, in a way, it's almost better to just know what few spells you have and commit to them, at least in my own opinion. Because generally you'll find that players really stick to their guns on what spells they're using, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I can certainly get that. Now when it comes the other thing is is the notion of spell stones, cuz you do have a bunch of different types across different levels. What exactly does the spellstone system entail?
So, spellstones are used in a lot of different ways. They're not mutually exclusive, but the ones that are denoted in the page that I provided you, that are listed by names such as fire, cold, lightning, wind, poison, etc., etc., are what is dubbed within the system as elemental spellstones. Remember earlier how I was saying that spirits of nature are essentially attuned to a specific kind of element, right?
Mm-hmm.
Spellstones are kind of like, if I had to describe it in a nice way, the excrement of spirits. Spirits eat mana, and the excrement is spellstones. Magic from a person like you or me, let's say, is kind of like water. You know what I mean? It's a substance that is useful by itself. And when cast at the lowest level, you might be able to tweak the flavor a little bit. Kind of like, if I had to say this in a night way, like the LaCroix of magic. Like if I were to come up to you and whisper in your ear, and this would be a level zero spell, something like, wait, and you would be like, oh, okay, well, I guess that's a wind spell. That's what level zero magic is. But spells above that level require spellstones to basically further flavor the magic to be strong enough. That's why those elemental spellstones are denoted. And they're rated level 1 to level 9, because the spellcasting system is rated from level 0 to level 9, and level 0s don't require you to have elemental spellstones, but they do require you to have an arcane conduit, which I can explain in a minute. So it's like, I want to cast a level 9 spell that requires these components. Here is the level 9 components that I have for the spell. In a way, when you look at systems where they're just sort of like, I wish to cast Fireball, that means I need to have Bat Guano and all this other stuff. Nobody ever uses it. It's tragically, like, how to say this? It's got so much flavor, but if you're using it, half of your time is going to be spent getting components, which is why the people take component pouches, or they don't use it at all. Elemental spellstones are meant to flavor your casting, but they're not mutually exclusive to do that. Elemental spellstones can actually just be thrown for like a set dice amount of damage, but there's also magic tools that will use them that can be used by combatant classes that allow them to get access to damage types other than the standard, you know, Pharah, bludgeoning, slashing, piercing, to use in combat without the need for them to get fancy magic items or dip into being a spellcaster. If they're willing to spend the money to acquire the resources, they can just as easily dole out damage the same way that maybe something like an arcanist could, or if I had to describe it, like a spellstoner could. They have to go out of their way to get the extra resources, sure, but they have the option, and it doesn't require them to spend hundreds upon thousands of gold coins to get fancy magic items, you know, with that on to it. While the system focuses a lot around elemental spellstones, there are other types of spellstones. And I'll try to limit how much of this I will talk about, but the primary one outside of that is a spellstone called Conduit Spellstone. And Conduit Spellstone is really good at drawing out and directing magic. And so every spellcaster and every arcanist, their arcane conduit, which is essentially, if I had to put it in D&D terms, their spellcasting focus, is made out of, at least partially, Conduit Spellstone. And Conduit Spellstone is used a lot in magic tools to make them function properly. And so that's what's sorted amongst the other resources. There's a lot of other there's a few other spell stones that I could talk about, but I think that would best answer your question. So if you're interested, though.
Yeah. And it is funny you mentioned the components thing, because I think that people would probably spend a bit more time with components if there was a justification for them. But because of the fact that D&D has this shit or get off the pot attitude when it comes to what sort of fantasy it is, and isn't willing to nail that down, there isn't the opportunity for that. Like, nobody bats an eye about, say, components being used in something like Warhammer. Mm-hmm. Because since Warhammer has a specific approach with magic and how it works, you can build around that. But something like D&D, because it's trying to be all kinds of fantasy, but also no. It doesn't have that chance to do that.
Yeah. D&D is really. And I don't say this to, like, tank on D&D, because D&D is a great system. It's just so many of the systems are passed over that they do have because they're not convenient to use. It's a weird thing. D&D leaves so much up to GMs that you would think, for the systems that they do include, people would want to use them, but their component systems are really, really, really... I don't have a great way of putting it, but clunky. Let's say clunky.
Jank.
I think that's... Jank is also a good way of putting it. I wanted to make... I figured this. If I'm going to make components a part of spellcasting, right? They can't feel clunky. Because if they feel clunky, nobody's going to want to use them. Well, what's the best way to make them not feel clunky? The answer is... to make them parts of crafting, or to make them accessible for everybody to a degree, and have the degree to which the accessibility is useful vary. You know what I mean? So there's nobody that an elemental spellstone is not useful to in any given circumstance.
Mm-hmm. And is it a case where when it comes to magic origin, is it something that just about anybody can take, or is it specifically those who are casters can take?
So actually, part of the character creation process states that everybody picks a magic origin when they create their characters, even if they're not an arcanist or a spellcaster. That's actually going to be something I've been considering for a while. I was considering potentially adding benefits for combatants where picking their magic origin, at certain levels they get benefits from the magic origin that they picked, if that makes sense. And I've been kind of like rolling around in my head how I'd want to do something like that. Mm-hmm. But at this point I've gotten so far into my system, I sit there and I'm just kind of like, if I had this, is it gonna like, you know, unravel the whole fabric of everything? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I can certainly understand that. One thing that I found kind of amusing is using a D100 for initiative. What prompted that idea?
God. Okay. So anybody who has ever played a D20 system has most likely encountered the big issue with having a D20 based initiative, which is, if you're running combat, you are generally going to have, at one point or several points, which I tend to have encountered several times later game, people who are rolling same or similar initiatives. The way I saw it, the D100 is this dice that really gets zero love. None. Everybody looks at the D100 and basically... in almost any system, the reason why it gets used is, here's your carousing table, here's your spellcasting list of effects, roll your D100, here's your wild magic table, you know, things like that.
Spell failure.
It's spell failure. It's a dice that gets no love. But the odds of you rolling the same initiative as someone on a D100 roll is phenomenally lower than rolling the same as like a D20 roll plus whatever your dex modifier is. Mm-hmm. I also, how to say this? This is going to be me tanking on D&D a little bit. I really
Everybody gets the roast here. Do not worry about whether or not you should or shouldn't tank on D&D. We roast everybody. I've referred to it as the most litigious role-playing game.
I'm going to tank on D&D for this. D&D mandates that you have dump stats, and those dump stats may not necessarily be negative. And what I mean by that is D&D requires you to basically have at least two positive dump stats if you want to do well, which is con and dex. And I've always hated that dexterity in D&D is tied to speed, or rather is tied to initiative, but is not tied to speed. Mm-hmm. And I also hate that every single ranged weapon in D&D is basically dex-based, aside from the one item for barbarians, what is it, throwing axes?
And have you ever tried to draw a bow?
Yeah, no, that shit. Forgive my language.
Don't worry about cursing.
I have my family's from New York, man. I'm used to it. I got tired of really seeing that, and in a way, it was almost tragic that you had Constitution, which is this required positive dump stat if you want to have any health. Mm-hmm. It's like it has nothing else going for it aside from more health and saving throws.
If you look at what each ability score actually contributes to, Dex is a hoarder.
Yes. Dex is like, behold, I am on finesse weapons. I am every single ranged weapon. I am part of your initiative. I am half of the saving throws required for D&D spells.
And a good chunk of skills as well. then you have something like Constitution, which is going to contribute to health and one skill.
No, there's actually not even one skill, I don't think. It's con saving throws, isn't it?
I do think that there is one skill that uses con, but still you're grasping at straws by that point.
Yeah, if it's 5e, there's actually none.
It is just saving throw. I don't know what I'm
saying. Yeah, I told you.
I think it's because I have so many different additions in my head that things can get crosswired.
They probably had it at one point. I mean, they've run now, I guess, what they're calling six editions with whatever the hell you want to call one D&D is.
I'm calling it missing the damn point if the playtest version of the Warlock is any indication.
Yeah.
Because seriously, what the hell were they thinking with that whole? Oh, we're gonna give the Warlock more spell slots at the cost of everything that makes the Warlock special.
Yep. No. I feel like it's required for every system to have one weird caster. Does that make sense? Warlock is one of those casters that I look at it and my brain just immediately bumps into the wall. I'm just sort of like, I don't know what's happening.
I mean, when it comes to
like, I feel like so many people were genuinely outraged about Warlock, and it generally just genuinely just went right over my head because I've only had one player who played any kind of Warlock in any of my sessions, and he was mostly Paladin.
The big appeal with Warlock has been yes they get the fewest amount of spells out of all the casters, but their spells automatically scale. And they get them back on a short rest. Both of those things were taken out.
Yep. It's kind of like going, yes, I see. You have this very interesting, one-of-a-kind kind of class, the only class that gets any kind of short rest benefits that's also a caster. But what if we just took away everything that made it like any kind of recognizable and just made it like every other caster class that there is?
Apparently, the push for one D&D is to try and streamline things. Except 5e is already pretty streamlined as it is, so I never saw the point. Conspiracy theorists are thinking that the reason they're doing this is to accommodate their attempt at a virtual tabletop, which, in my opinion, is not going to do well because they decided to use Unreal Engine for it.
Yeah,
and put it on consoles.
Yeah, you could not streamline D&D any more than it is streamlined in 5e, short of making it like a perfectly sheer surface sphere.
I think if you were to try and streamline things further, you would end up with something like Morkborg, which the whole rule set can be on a single page, because early on it was. But one of the things that I find interesting with the D100 approach that you're doing is instead of your stats creating a higher ceiling, it's creating a higher floor.
Yep.
So is it a case where somebody rolled lower than what you had written, their highest ability score times proficiency bonus, that they would just re-roll, and if they keep rolling low, they just keep re-rolling until they stop getting something that low?
If they roll below that, their initiative becomes that total.
Ah.
The exception to that is a natural one. Which, if you roll a 1 on a D100, how? If you roll a 1 on a D100, you basically get one round of combat in which you're basically, like, stunned, tripped up, whatever have you, even with that baseline ceiling. Or floor, rather. While there is a baseline under which you technically cannot go under, which gives you some level of security, mm-hmm. If you really mess up, like really, really mess up, which happens sometimes, you know, I think that's part of the fun of D&D is, or D20 systems in general, is that you can mess up, like, real bad. Like, some DMs really don't like doing the whole reward nat 20s, punish nat 1 system. I'm of that camp. I really like punishing nat 1s and rewarding D20s. I think it's really great when players can get a little bit bang for their buck, and I think it's really just part of the whole experience when a player gets their kneecap bashed in. That's just part of life.
The joke that I have made for the longest time is that the dice gods are a model of equality. It does not matter your race, your sex, your place of origin, your occupation, your orientation, what have you. The dice gods hate you.
Yep. Yep.
And given the fact that you have this concept of main actions, secondary actions, and tertiary actions in your economy of action, mm-hmm. I'm curious if some of that was done to address the bonus action thing, where everybody seems to have some form of bonus action, but it's never nailed down how many of those you actually get.
Yeah. So you get one of each action type. So there's, like you said, main actions, secondary actions, and tertiary actions. And then outside of those, there are reactions and spontaneous actions, which we can talk a little bit about.
Yeah.
Main actions are primarily used, like you probably noted inside of the provided supplement, that they're mainly used for really attacking. They can be used for outside of attacking. Ironically, even when used outside of attacking for class features, most of those class features are just a specialized form of attack. Mm. Secondary actions are listed as being... and I just want to make sure that I'm getting this right, because I've made so much content at this point that sometimes even I'm just like, what did I write at one point? Secondary actions are mostly utilized for class features that are not attacking, essentially.
weapon attacks typically cannot be made with it as secondary actions, though there are talents or class features that allow you to do something similar. There's certain weapon properties that allow you to use secondary actions. And then tertiary actions are things like I'm going to load ammunition to my crossbow. They can be used to make up to 2 skill checks per round, or you can use it to make saving throws against every effect that you're under from a condition or affliction to resist those effects and otherwise end them during combat. As a note that I would like to make is that main actions, secondary actions, both have alternative action uses. So D&D, if I had to give an example from an action that everybody's familiar with in D&D, that's an alternative to your main action. Dashing. Dashing is something that I'm pretty sure everybody who's played D&D at least once has done. Mm-hmm. For my alternative main actions, there's 8 alternative actions. And for secondary actions, there is 3 alternative secondary actions. And for reactions, there are actually 4 types of reactions. And those are reactions that anybody can make or take, regardless of their class.
Right, that certainly makes sense. When it comes to reactions, as well as spontaneous, where would the line be drawn between the two? Since both of them you can do when it's not your turn.
Reactions are really for something that is happening around you. And spontaneous actions are for something is happening to somebody you are allied with that is within a certain range of you. I believe I particularly denoted it as being within your dash range. So the range of it varies depending on how you're playing your character. Reactions are all about somebody is attacking me, or somebody is moving away from me, or I am being attacked, so that's about me, you know. They're all about me. Mm-hmm. Spontaneous actions are more like, if I'm 90% sure everybody has run into this particular instance when they're playing any kind of campaign. Oh no, my ally is being attacked by this dude who is definitely about to send them from here to God. Oh no, they're going to have to make some kind of saving throw that they're really bad at, but I'm really good at. Or, oh no, you know, XYZ's thing is happening to them that they are not good at, that I am good at, that I could probably tank, that I could otherwise... You get the idea. Spontaneous actions are meant to be like, considering you're probably pretty into media, you probably know the trope of, young student is being attacked by much more powerful ally, master throws themselves in the way of the line of fire and dies because of it. Mm-hmm. It's like a really common trope in most forms of media. If I had to describe the one that comes to mind for me, I always think of that scene in Dragon Ball Z where Piccolo throws himself in front of Gohan to save him from Nappa.
Yeah.
That's kind of what spontaneous actions are. Spontaneous actions are throw yourself into the line of fire for somebody else's sake. Skip your next round of combat. Because you've technically used all of your energy and actions to commit to that one spontaneous action. So you don't get to move or anything like that. You don't get to take your main actions or anything. You basically skip your next turn. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's the way you describe it, it sounds like it's a way to... jump ahead in line, but that comes with a cost.
Yes. It's exactly that.
So, I remember going through the concept of damage weaknesses, and the concept of critical weakness came up, but that was mentioned as a option, as a more advanced ruling. Is critical weakness a case where if they're critted against, then there's an extra effect, or is it something different?
It's roughly put, it's just more damage. It's intrinsically tied to a particular system. So my system is already kind of meant to be a little bit more of an advanced system to begin with. It's supposed to be a nice, friendly intersection between D&D and Pathfinder, where Pathfinder is so very intimidating because it's so very complex in addition to their depth, and D&D is kind of so streamlined to the point where it feels like everything relies upon you. My system's trying to be like, here are the rules. I'm telling you the rules. You understand how the rules work, and I've tried to make sure that the rules work as seamlessly as possible, which gives you a lot of depth to work with, but I've tried very hard to make sure that they are easily understood, especially by anybody who has picked up a D20 system before. Critical weakness is tied to a sort of advanced optional ruling for my system that is referred to as basically, precise strike, which is, if I had to say it the nice way, strike the weak point for massive damage. Every creature, you know, like we think of the tropes with, let's use Zelda as an example. Every boss in Zelda, or at least one boss in Zelda, always has the eyes for the weakness. There's always at least one. If I had to describe it, precise strike is a lot like that. Strike is, I've precisely striked this creature's weak point with damage type that it is weak against, and now it has received critical weakness damage, which ups it from 2x the damage to 4x the damage.
When you mentioned that, one of the first things that came to mind is that one specific weakness that Smaug had in The Hobbit.
You know, oh man,
where you essentially had to essentially the only way to really hurt him was to hit this one specific spot on his underbelly, because so much of his body was armored.
Yep. If I had to put it one way, it's like Achilles heel.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
But when I also saw that you have an, obviously there's the spell point thing, but you also have stamina points.
Mm-hmm.
Would a lot of the martial classes be the ones using stamina points more often, or is stamina points some sort of extra effort system?
Stamina points can be gained by a handful of different ways. Spellcasting, files, and certain forms of rest allow you to acquire stamina points. Stamina points can function like temp HP does in D&D, basically acting as an extra cushion for you to take more damage with them, taking priority over them. There's actually one class that works very handedly with this called Hemomancer that I could talk about at one point, but there is a set of extra resources that you can look at underneath stamina points that state you can expend stamina points basically as a tertiary action to gain certain benefits, and that could be like an extra attack, it could be an extra secondary action, it could be an extra this or that kind of thing. It could be using these specific action types as like, you know, a bonus, a secondary action on this turn, you know, all sorts of different things. There it's a table, essentially. Quantities of 10 expended at certain levels to acquire benefits. Stamina points represent, quite frankly, the extra well of stamina that you have within yourself to commit to doing certain actions that can definitely benefit you. It allows you a lot more flexibility within combat when you have something like stamina points, because it's either hold on to these, take a little bit of extra damage, or leave them be and hold on to them and use them when I need them for an extra resource, such as maybe an extra attack or a certain action type or things such as that.
Mm-hmm.
They definitely do benefit combatants more, I would say that much.
Yeah, because if you look at something like, say, Dragon Age or World of Warcraft, the martial classes will have energy as a resource, and I was curious if stamina points were used in a manner similar to that. Oh, but it sounds like it can. Now, since multi-class is one part of the character sheet, I'm curious if you're handling multi-classing the same way the world's most litigious role-playing game did, or if you have a different approach.
Could I ask you to elaborate a little bit on what you mean? I'm a little bit, admittedly, not as familiar with D&D's multiclassing, though I do know you can multiclass into more than two classes, and that generally benefits start from the lowest level. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, there's also the fact that you need certain that in order to qualify for multiclassing, you need certain ability scores at certain values.
So yes, I do still use that. Albeit the cap is not very high to begin with for most of those. Most of them can usually be taken so long as you're at least positive in one of the stats exclusively. So you don't need to have multiple ability scores above a certain level to take it. It's generally one. Which logically makes sense, you know. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense to play something that requires you to use dexterity and then you have negative dexterity, you know. There is that, and the number of times you can multi-class is limited to a maximum of two different classes. Generally, you find that people who are multi-classing anyways don't tend to go very far beyond two anyways, to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and usually if they do, they'll end up doing so in a bit of... In order to get some sort of build, although I've never been a big fan of some of the traps that can happen with multiclassing. Then again, my GM isn't fond of me playing sorcerer paladin multiclasses, because they know that I'm gonna do ridiculous things with it.
Yep. It's like I'm fine with multiclassing, but generally you won't find anybody doing more than two at a time anyways, because you'll be surprised at how quickly spread thin you are when you dump yourself into too many different classes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it certainly can, and at that point, if you're multiclassing into like three or four classes, then the bigger question is why aren't you just doing a game that goes full freeform?
Yeah.
But with all of that in mind, what would you be shooting for as far as the page count for the full thing?
Oh. That's a bit of a loaded question because this is unformatted. Currently the unformatted page book is encroaching probably on more than 800 pages. Part of that is because there is not great ways of formatting what is really short lists that I do in bullet point fonts, which artificially increases the page counts reasonably. I would say if you slap together D&D's or any systems, like the player's guide, the DM's guide, and probably... Because my content will include not only the main rulings and all the stuff for all the classes, it's going to include the spell list, it's going to be including the list for magic items as well as magic tools. Ironically, most of the things pertaining to monsters is primarily going to be kept within the creature guide. So while it touches a little bit on it in the main rules, most of what you need to know about creatures is actually inside of the creature guide. I was planning on doing it in those as two books and then doing a third book, which is just the initial adventure. So it's quite a tally of pages at this point. I would say reasonably, even when everything's said and done and I formatted everything, I still expect it to be at around 800 pages.
Mm-hmm. And I will certainly be looking forward to seeing how it develops. But with all that said, I do want to sincerely thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to come all the way to my temple and enjoy the madness that happens here.
Oh, yeah, no, definitely. I'm glad to be here. if you do ever wind up having any more questions, you know, definitely feel free to DM me. I'm always happy to come back and talk more about this if you find yourself having more questions. Mm-hmm.
And anytime you see fit to return, the door is always open. As I often say around here, drinking is not mandatory, but it is encouraged.
Man, I could go for a good drink right now.
And of course, a sincere thanks goes out to everyone who took the time out of their schedule to come onto the show and enjoy the madness. And there will be plenty more where that came from, as there always is here, on the open bar of the internet. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra, I am your gaming monk, stay fucking frosty, everybody!